began a series of sermons on last Sunday for the next several, don't know how long, weeks, months, how long, however long the Spirit leads us. We'll be in summer school here at the Bella Vista Missionary Baptist Church. That's the name of our series, Summer School, Learning the Fundamentals of the Faith. As I mentioned to you on last week, that this sermon series is born out of a hope and out of a desire that we as the people of God will not just have a greater understanding for those truths that we proclaim, but also that we would be better equipped as the people of God for the times in which we live. I said to you that now more than ever, Christians and those who profess to be such are really going to have to stand and fight for what it is that they believe in. And oftentimes we become defeated as believers because many of us really don't have a good grasp on what it is that we believe. We simply believe because we grew up in church, or it was what mom taught us or what dad taught us, but we really have not delved into a deeper understanding of what it is that we believe. But even as we read today in our responsive reading, Peter says that we as believers ought to always be ready to give a defense, to give an answer for the hope that we have in Jesus Christ. And so my goal is to prepare us. And so as I said on last week, I hope that you come on these Sunday mornings with really a heart and a mind to learn. It's all right to celebrate and to sing and to shout, but we need to know and understand what it is that we're shouting about. Amen. 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 And so it is my prayer that these lessons, these messages would strengthen your faith. For many of us, it's revisiting information that we already know. For some of us, it's new information. But we certainly want you to grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We began part one last week talking about the supremacy of the Scriptures. That's the starting point for us as believers. That if we don't accept the Bible as the inspired, authoritative Word of God, then nothing after that matters. But we have to understand that the Bible is not just words about God, but they are in fact the very words of God. It is a God-breathed book. It is a living book. It is an alive book. We talked about that on last week. If you're not here, you definitely want to get that CD or that DVD. I believe that it will be a blessing to you. Amen. Also, as I mentioned last week, if you want to know where I'm gleaning the starting point of the material that I'm using for these sermon series, when you get home, there's something that is unique to the Baptist denomination. We have something called the Baptist Articles of Faith. The Baptist Articles of Faith. This is a framework that has been given to us to help give us a foundation for what it is that we believe. I said to you last week, if you have a good hymn book, most of the time you can find those 18 articles at the back of that hymn book. If not, you can go on, y'all know we Google everything these days. You can go on Google and just look up the Baptist Articles of Faith. You can find them there. Amen. So I want to move today as we talked about the Word of God. We talked about the Bible on last week. Today we want to talk about the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible. I want to invite your attention to the book of Psalms, the hymn book of the Bible, Psalm 14. Psalm 14. Amen. Psalm 14. And if you're taking notes today, we're going to be sharing quite a bit of information, reveal a little bit more. Last week was informative, but this will be even more informative. Amen. Psalm 14. When you found that passage, say, I have it.
I have it.
Amen. I want to look today only at verse number 1. And I want to read today from the New King James Version of God's Word. Here's what it says. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. They are corrupt. They have done abominable works. There is none who does good. I want to focus on that A clause of the verse again. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Amen. You may be seated. The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Last week, lesson 1, we talked about the supremacy of the scriptures. Today in lesson 2 of this summer school series, I want to talk about the existence of the eternal. The existence of the eternal. If I were to give it a subtopic, I would simply label it, don't be a fool. The existence of the eternal. Everybody say that with me. The existence of the eternal. Amen. Brothers and sisters, I've heard several times in recent years a true story about the greatest boxer of all time, Muhammad Ali. The story goes that on a plane one day, Ali was sitting in first class and a flight attendant came to him and asked him to buckle his seatbelt as the plane was nearing takeoff. She would then leave to attend other passengers on the plane, only to come back moments later and discover that Ali had not yet buckled his seatbelt. Growing impatient with him, she would repeat her initial instructions by saying, I'm sorry, Mr. Ali, but you are going to have to buckle your seatbelt. And then she left once again to fulfill other duties. Moments before takeoff, the attendant decided to do one last walkthrough. And when she got to Ali's seat, she would discover yet again that Ali still had not yet buckled his seatbelt. In a mildly frustrated voice, the attendant would then say to Mr. Ali, sir, we can't move until you buckle your seatbelt. Mr. Ali replied, I don't need to buckle my seatbelt. What do you mean you don't need to buckle your seatbelt, said the attendant. Everybody has to buckle their seatbelt. Brothers and sisters, if you know anything about Muhammad Ali, you know that he was not known for his modesty or meekness. And so then Ali would arrogantly and audaciously respond to her by saying, well, Superman don't need no seatbelt. The flight attendant was now ticked off. Mr. Ali had gotten on her last piece of nerve. And she looked squarely at him and said, yes, it is true, Mr. Ali, that Superman does not need a seatbelt. But please remember, Mr. Ali, that Superman don't need no airplane either. Brothers and sisters, this humorous confrontation that takes place between Muhammad Ali and this anonymous flight attendant should for us today serve as a profitable precaution and a stern safeguard to help us be ever mindful of the fact that we as human beings must know our limitations. In other words, those of us who live in this world must cognitively and spiritually embrace that we are not, hear me, superhuman beings. Nor do we possess sovereign superhuman powers that make us self-sufficient or self-sustaining. No, we are all finite, frail, feeble, faulty, and fickle human beings. And the moment that we decide or believe that we can live a secure life without the stabilizing seatbelt of God's sovereignty, we are in for a rude and rough awakening. Simply stated, friends, only a fool would subscribe to the belief or showcase the type of behavior that denounces, denies, and dismisses the existence of an eternal God that holds us and the world together. That is to say, brothers and sisters, the existence of God is mankind's sovereign seatbelt. These are the sentiments of the musical monarch and the sweet singing songs of Israel, King David, here in Psalm 14. Perhaps in a rare moment of repose and relaxation from his monarchal responsibilities, David, during some quiet and still devotional time with God, would begin to reflect on the foolishness of those who claim that there is no God. Theologians and historians are not quite sure as to what prompted David to pen this psalm, but in it, he clearly articulates how a life that dismisses the existence of God can result not just in spiritual death and moral decay, but it can also result in socially destructive behavior. The Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann comments on this psalm by saying, "The attitudes and the actions of this group of destructive people negate everything on which life depends." Hear me. They do not love God, and as a result, they do not love their neighbor. The entirety of the psalm explains this premise in more depth, but verse 1 of the psalm provides us with the main idea of David's musings and our discussions for this Sunday morning. It is here, brothers and sisters, that David, hear me, don't miss this, equates atheism, which is a lack of belief in God, he equates it to absurdity. And he considers faithlessness in a sovereign, supreme, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent, and omnibenevolent God as foolishness. He writes, "The fool has said in his heart, there is no God." To be sure, brothers and sisters, it is noteworthy to understand, before we delve deeper into our lesson on today, that when David refers to those who subscribe to an atheistic viewpoint as fools, he is not suggesting that these people are unintelligent or mentally incapacitated. But he is indicating that they are morally perverse. Look at what he says. "The fool has said in his heart." That's the seat of morality. This is what makes their foolishness and unbelief. This is what makes their foolishness and unbelief in God not a matter of the head, but a matter of the heart. Proverbs 9 and 10 records that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Therefore, hear me good, when people don't fear God in their hearts, they have no wisdom, spiritually or otherwise, and this is what makes them foolish. In other words, you can have an IQ of 160. But if God is not in your heart, my brother, my sister, you are a fool. Living in a cultural context, brothers and sisters, where the statistics of those who identify themselves as atheistic is increasing, and where organizations such as the modern atheist movement are gaining more traction and advancing in their efforts to edit God out of the vocabulary of mankind, it is relatively appropriate to say that we as believers are living in foolish times and amongst foolish people. who in the face of overwhelming evidence denied the existence of the one true and living God. It is my prayer today that through this lesson, your faith in the existence of the eternal God will be affirmed or reaffirmed, not just with your lips, but more importantly, with your life. In short, I don't want you to be a fool. I say again, only a fool would subscribe to the belief or showcase the type of behavior, hold on to that, that denounces, denies, and dismisses the existence of an eternal God that holds the world and us together. No matter what the culture presupposes, brothers and sisters, we believe in the words of our article of faith that there is one and only one living and true God, an infinite intelligent spirit whose name is Jehovah, the maker and supreme ruler of heaven and earth, inexpressibly glorious in holiness and worthy of all possible honor, confidence, and love, that in the unity of the Godhead, there are three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, equal in divine perfection and executing distinct but harmonious offices in the great work of redemption. That is to simply say, brothers and sisters, that God is real. God is real. And if we're going to be people of faith who are living in these shifting cultural times, we need to be able to stand on the affirmation that we serve a true and living God. Today I want to show us two ways by which we can avoid being or becoming foolish and faithless in the cultural context in which we live. First of all, brothers and sisters, and again, this is not the traditional expository sermon that I would normally use, but it's more topical. But it is foolish to say or believe that there is no God because, here's the first point, reason determines God's existence. Let me say that again for those of you who are taking notes. It is foolish to say that there is no God because reason, and what I mean by reason is rational thinking. Rational thinking determines God's existence. Now, I must say here, brothers and sisters, that this is not a point that I would typically argue in a sermon to help prove or validate the existence of God, simply because, hear me, we have been called to be people of faith. And because we have been called to faith, we should believe in God by faith and not by mental analysis. In other words, I'm not standing up here and giving you this argument to convince you by reason that God is real. That is something that you have to believe by faith in your heart. However, because I spent some time this past week perusing the National Atheist website in an attempt to learn more about their aims and principles, I discovered that one of the core principles of atheism is to, as they say, unreservedly accept, don't miss it, the supremacy of reason and aim at establishing a lifestyle and ethical outlook verifiable by experience and scientific method, and independent of all arbitrary assumptions of authority and creed. There's a whole bunch of big words. This simply says, this is what the atheist viewpoint is, this simply says that if it cannot be logically explained or scientifically proven, the atheist says that it does not exist. If I can't explain it in a mental capacity, or if I can't put it through some type of experiment, if I can't put God under a microscope to determine the existence of God, then God does not exist. This is the claim that atheism makes of God. They purport That because the existence of God does not make rational sense, or because we cannot empirically prove his existence, that he does not exist. This is their premise for denying and denouncing the reality of God. This premise for unbelief, hear me, would almost make sense. But today, I want to introduce you to a logical argument that not only reasonably explains the existence of God, but it also blows a gaping hole in the entire foundation of the atheistic argument. It is called, brothers and sisters, for those of you taking notes, the ontological argument. The ontological argument. That word ontological, the root word there, onto, simply means being. The ending word logical means a study. So it is a study of being. It was given to us by the early church father, St. Anselm of Canterbury, in the 11th century. And it is the premier logical argument for the existence of God. Listen, hear me. It does not require the use of the scientific method, but rather it arrives at the certain conclusion. Don't miss that. The certain conclusion, not the probable one, the certain conclusion that God does exist on the basis of simple deductive reasoning. In fact, brothers and sisters, this argument came into fruition through a time of devotional prayer when St. Anselm was meditating on Psalm 14. And as he read, he earnestly sought to offer an argument for the existence of God that would convince the fool in Psalm 14 that God is in fact real. And I want to equip you today with this tool that you can use when you are confronted by some fools who say there is no God. I want to equip you today to deal with some individuals who subscribe to an atheistic belief. Media team is going to help me out with this PowerPoint. And it's a whole lot of words, but I'm going to try to make it as plain as I can. So don't get so caught up in the words. I'm going to try to make it as simple as I can for you. And again, this is something that you can look up at home. And this is a good tool that you can use that will just throw an atheist off. Right? It's called the ontological argument. And it proves the existence of God by reason. Okay? Here's the first premise. This is the most important thing. Let's say that we don't even call God God. This is what Anselm is saying. This is number one. Let's say that God is understood or defined as a being than which nothing greater can be conceived. Hold on to the word greater. Let's say that God is defined as a being than which nothing greater can be conceived. That means that it doesn't get any better than God. Right? That God is a being that nothing greater can be conceived. Now, here's where it blows a hole in the premise of the atheistic argument. Watch it. Because the very fact that the atheists deny there is no God, watch it. In their denial, they are actually affirming that there is a possibility that there is one. Why are you dismissing something that does not have the possibility of existence? Okay? And so Anselm says, even the fool possesses this concept of God because they view God as that which nothing greater can be conceived. Now, here's the second thing. A thing, still talking about God, it exists either in the understanding only, such as, and this is just an example, it exists in the understanding only, such as the idea of a painting before it is painted, or in both the understanding and reality, such as existing in the mind of the painter and then existing on the canvas. In other words, if I'm a painter, I have an image in my mind, and I'm standing in front of the canvas. I have an image in my mind of what I want the finished product to look like on the canvas. And so there's only two ways by which something can exist. It either exists in my mind, or it exists in reality. Okay, y'all got that? Okay, it's like if I had $1 million. It can exist in my mind, But he can also exist in reality. Here's the third premise. Go to the next screen. Okay. Now, it is greater, continue to hold on to greater, because God is greater than that. Nothing greater can be conceived than God. If it is greater to exist, it is greater to exist in reality than to exist merely in the understanding. Right? In other words, which one is greater? For me to have $1 million in my mind or for me to have $1 million in my hand? Which one is greater? To have it in reality. Right? Okay? Which takes us to number four. If God merely exists in the understanding, which is only in the mind, then God is not the greatest possible being. If he only exists in the mind. Why? Since a being that existed in reality would be greater than a being that existed in the mind. Which takes us to number five. It affirms our premise. But God is, by definition, the greatest possible being. This goes back to number one. That God is understood and defined as a being in which nothing greater can be conceived. So then, number six, therefore, God exists not merely in the mind, as the fool claims, but in reality as well. See how that messes them up? If you only think he exists in the mind, but you claim that there's nothing greater than God that can be conceived, it's greater to exist in reality than it is in the mind. Therefore, God must exist. Because there's nothing greater than him. And so we see, brothers and sisters, by reason alone, we can determine, if I couldn't put God under a microscope, just by simple reason, if you want to go that route, I can determine that God does exist outside of biblical presuppositions and without any need of scientific proof. God's existence would still be absolute. Why? Because simple logic and reason demands it. If then, don't miss this, if then a person denies and dismisses the reality of God, it cannot be legitimately on the basis of reason. So it must be on the basis of free will rejection. Let me say that one more time. If anybody denies or denounces and dismisses the reality of God, it can't be legitimately on reason, so it must be on the basis of free will rejection. In other words, when the fool says in his heart that there is no God, what he is really saying is that there is a God, but there just isn't a God for me. This, brothers and sisters, is the heart of the fool. Simple reasoning notwithstanding, the fool will denounce the reality of God because in his or her mind, it is easier to reject a God to whom they will be accountable to than to accept him and live under his sovereign authority rather than their own autonomy. The word of caution today, however, is simple. You may willfully reject God down here, but one of these old days, every knee shall bow of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. God is real, and whether you want to accept him or not, one of these days you're going to find out for yourself that he is in fact the true and living God. Only the fool. Says in his heart, there is no God. Because reason alone determines his existence. Can I give you one more thing? I'm almost through. It is foolish to say that God does not exist. Not only because reason determines his existence, but secondly, because revelation declares God's existence. Revelation, let the church say revelation. Revelation declares God's existence. What I mean by declares here is that revelation testifies to the existence of God. Theologian Lillard Erickson says, because humankind is finite, that means we are limited. And God is infinite. He's unlimited. We cannot know God unless he reveals himself to us. Because we are finite and he is infinite, we cannot know God unless he reveals himself to us. He is correct in that statement, because if the Bible teaches us anything, it teaches that our God is an incomprehensible God. That is to say, our human minds cannot grasp the knowledge of who God is. Isaiah 40 and 18 records, to whom then would you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare to him? God is an incomprehensible God. But although God is incomprehensible, the scriptures also teach us that he is at the same time knowable. He is a knowable God. We're going to turn that today, but look at 1 John 5 and 20 when you get home. Mark that down. 1 John 5 and 20. It will show you that God, although he is incomprehensible, to a certain degree, he is able to be known. Now, to be clear, to say that God is knowable is not to assert that we can know everything about God. But it is to say that God can be made known through certain aspects of divine revelation. Let the church say divine revelation. Simply stated, friends, the person who makes the claim that God does not exist simply isn't paying attention. God is everywhere. And if you make the claim that there is no God, you're not paying attention. Historically, the two avenues through which God has taken the initiative to reveal himself have been labeled, and these are two things you can write down to look up in your own study time, have been labeled as special and general revelation. Special and general revelation. For the purpose of time today, I only want to deal with the general revelation of God. But to give you a brief synopsis of special revelation, this is special revelation in a nutshell. It is when God communicated with particular people at a particular time to communicate his message, which is now only available through Scripture. In other words, the Bible, as we talked about last week, the Bible is special revelation of God. The words that the Holy Spirit inspired the writers to write, that was special revelation. Okay. When Jesus Christ was incarnated and came in the flesh, that was a special revelation of God. Other instances when you read in Scripture, when Moses is confronted by the burning bush on the backside of the desert, that is a special revelation of the theophany, as it is called. That was given to everybody, didn't get that experience. It was unique to particular people at particular times. General revelation, however, this is what we're going to deal with, refers to God's communication of himself to all people at all times and in all places. That's general revelation. God communicates himself to all people at all times and in all places. In other words, this is the revelation of God's existence that everybody can see because it is universally available. I say again, the person who makes the foolish claim that there is no God is not paying attention, because God is in fact everywhere. Scripture informs us of at least two modes of general revelation, of God's general revelation of himself. And these two things I'm going to give you when we're done.
And that is, God reveals himself through his creation. And he reveals himself through his creatures. He reveals himself through creation and through his creatures. Let's deal with the first one, revelation through creation. Scripture itself, brothers and sisters, proposes that there is a knowledge of God that we can see through his creation. Theologians would call this the cosmological argument for God's existence. Okay, we see this, if you turn a few pages over, in Psalm 19, verses 1 and 2. And the psalmist talks about how the glory of God and the existence of God is revealed in creation itself. Verses 1 and 2 of Psalm 19 says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament shows his handiwork. Day unto day utters speech, and night unto night reveals" what? Knowledge. According to the psalmist, the very sky upon which you and I gaze each and every day of our lives speak to the existence of a glorious God. If you've ever witnessed the majestic rising of the sun or viewed the beauty of a sunset, you've seen the greatness of God. God is everywhere. God is in the trees. God is in the mountains. God is in the waters. His very creation attests to his existence, attests to his knowledge and revelation of himself. That's why the psalmist could pick up the pen and piece of paper and say, "Oh Lord, our God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works that thy hands have made, I see the stars and I hear the roaring thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed." And when he reflects on that, he says, "Then sings my soul." Sometimes you want to just look at the sky and your heart just all starts singing. "Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me, how great thou art." God is everywhere. His creation testifies to that. And sometimes we miss the glory of God and the revelation of himself because we take his creation for granted. We treat it as something that's mundane and run of the mill. But who else but a God can create something as glorious and as beautiful as the stars in the sky? Who else but a God can create mountains and oceans, animal life, and that's God. It's revealed in his creation. Furthermore, and you can turn here with me, turn to Romans 1 and 18. Furthermore, the Apostle Paul would write in Romans 1, 18 through 32, that God's wrath has been kindled against mankind because we have willfully turned a blind eye to the manifestation of himself that was given in and through creation. Let me just read it to you. The Bible speaks for itself. Romans 1 and 18. It says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men." Here it is. "Who suppress the truth in unrighteousness. Because what may be known of God is manifest in them." Why? "For God has shown it to them. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen." And say, God is everywhere. "Being understood by the things that are made. even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. You ain't got no excuses. God has shown you in creation that he is real. Verse 21. Because although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful, but became futile in their thoughts, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Here's our word, verse 22. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds and four-footed animals and creeping things. Therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lusts of their hearts, to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for a lie, and worship and serve the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burn in their lust for one another, men with men, committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which was due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind. King James said, a reprobate mind. To do those things which are not fitting. Being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undeserving, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who knowing the righteous judgment of God, that those who practice such things are deserving of death. But before you get too holy and say, I don't do none of this, the last clause of the verse says, not only do the same, but also those who approve of those who practice them. Creation is everywhere. The proof of his existence is everywhere. And the reason that mankind and humankind has fallen in the way that it has fallen, and the reason that we are headed in a downward spiral in the way that we are headed in a downward spiral, is because we are ignoring the knowledge and the reality of a true and living God that we are confronted with on a daily basis. This is the issue of the atheistic fool. The fool says in his heart, there is no God. Watch this. Because he or she wants to live any kind of way. At the end of the day, that's what it's about. Many of you can remember one of the most famous atheists in modern times was Madeline Murray O'Hare. One of the persons who was solely responsible for getting prayer out of the school system. Her son, William, who was also an atheist, he quotes her in something that she had said before her death. Madeline Murray O'Hare says, I'm an atheist, not because I've searched behind every star and looked under every rock to prove there's no God. Here it is. I'm an atheist because I want to live my life as if there is no God. That, brothers and sisters, is the heart of a man. That because I do not want to be accountable to a sovereign God, it's easier for me to reject his existence and live how I want to live, than to affirm and accept his existence and be accountable to what he has said to do in his word. long. We see God's revelation through his creation. But then finally, we see God's revelation through his creatures. And what I mean by that, namely, are other human beings. This is to say, brothers and sisters, that if you want to know whether or not there is a God, just look at the crown jewel of his creation. Human beings. Psalm 8, you can read it when you get home. It talks about how we as humans are the crown jewels of God's creation. According to scripture, we are all created in the imago Dei, the image of God. We possess morality, intelligence, emotions, and a God consciousness. This is what shoots the theory of evolution in the foot. For evolution cannot produce soul. Evolution cannot produce conscience. Evolution cannot produce God instincts. In the words of Charles Ryrie, lifeless idols do not generate living offspring. The existence of God is never more clearly seen than it is in each and every one of us. This is why it's difficult for me to conceive how a person or a group of people can look at another human being and value their life over that of another person. I can't conceive that. Especially the ones who claim to be Christian. And the one who claims to know God. Because if you claim to know God, and you believe that God is real, then you understand that God is the Father of us all. That God created us all. Red, yellow, black, and white, we're all precious in his sight. And so how can you value the life of another individual over your own? When we devalue and degrade one another, whether in our conversations or our interactions, hear me, and if you don't hear nothing else or remember anything else I say, remember this. When we do that, although we are not atheistic in principle, that means in our beliefs, when we do that type of stuff, we become atheistic in our practice. That is our behavior. And so, as I'm coming to a close, you want to know what's promulgating the atheistic movement? It's Christians who are behaving like atheists. You want to know why people are falling away from God, falling away from the church? Because we're not behaving as children and people of God are supposed to behave. And so the challenging question that you have to ask yourself today is, am I a Christian atheist? Although I believe in God, in principle, am I atheistic in my practices? Because I'm not spreading the love of God and living in life in a way that brings glory to the name of God. I'm done. But only a fool would deny and denounce the existence of an eternal God. The reason and the revelation are both there. But you have to decide for yourself whether to accept him or reject him. Brothers and sisters, I don't know what course you may take. But my testimony is this. There are some things that I may not know. There are some places that I cannot go. But I am sure of this one thing. That God is real. For I can feel Him deep in my soul. Some folk may doubt. Some folk may scorn. All can desert and leave me alone. But as for me, I'll take God's part. For God is real. And I can feel Him in my heart. I wonder if I got anybody around Bella Vista this Sunday morning who can testify with me. Yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. He's real, for He has washed and made me whole. His love for me is just like pure gold. He's real. For I can feel Him in my soul. Only the fool says in his heart, there is no God. It reasonably makes no sense. And through revelation, it makes no sense. The option is just up to you whether you choose to accept the reality of a true and living God or whether you choose to reject Him. We'll get ready to extend the invitation. As the deacons are coming, there is something known. Before we sing, there is something known. As Pascal's wager. Many of you, if you're in the field of mathematics, you're familiar with that name, Blaise Pascal. And he contributes a formula to the theological argument to the existence of God. And in a nutshell, he's basically saying that God is a safe bet to make. The premise of the argument is simply this: I'd rather live my life like there is a God and die to find out that there isn't one than to live my life like there isn't a God and not to find out there is. That's a good approach to take. And although that may be a safe bet, it is not a sure bet. It's not a sure bet. Because what Pascal is saying there is that there's a possibility of me getting into heaven based on what I do and how I live, based on my merits. But brothers and sisters, that's not how it works. Jesus told Nicodemus, you must be born again. That is to say, you must accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Because really, that's what the atheists say. I can be a nice person. I can be a philanthropist. I can do all these wonderful things without accepting the reality of a true and living God. And yes, you can. And at the end of the day, you can be a good person that's still on their way to hell. Because you did not accept Jesus Christ. And so as we're all standing, if you're here today, maybe you haven't been atheistic in principle, but you've been atheistic in practice. Saying, I don't need to be a part of the church. I don't need to accept Jesus Christ. I'm going to just live my life and be a good person and that'll be good enough to get me in. Don't be fooled. Don't be a fool, brothers and sisters. Don't deny God in your heart.